Just remember, Ben, I'm always the last one who gets up here, so I'll get you back. We're glad you're with us today, and boy, it's just so, you know, crazy how time flies. And I can remember when I was living out in Arizona, you know, I had a job at a fitness center, and I was about 20 at the time. I was going to University of Arizona in Tucson, and there was a guy would come in, and he would work out. He was about 40, and I just kept thinking about that all the time. He would talk to me. Of course, I was, you know, would help work out, and he would just talk to me about, you know, he's starting to get some arthritis and things are bothering him. I'm thinking, well, you know, I couldn't even go there, you know. And I think, bam, I even only hit 40. I'm just way past that now. And it's like, what happens, you know? And as our time goes before us, I want us to look at what we're going to look at God's word today. That God tells us that he gives us wisdom. We're going to talk some about that today. But it's like having money in the bank. You can have all the money in the bank, but if you don't put it into action, in other words, if you don't spend it, use it, whatever, when we die, it's just going to go to somebody else. And the same with wisdom, and we're going to take it one step further today. Wisdom turns into discernment. In other words, it's the actual action plan for your life. You can have all the wisdom from the Lord, but until you actually realize that the Lord's given you wisdom to have that insight with discernment, we're going to try and work through all that today. Because I can guarantee this, and then we'll pray. Everybody in here today, there's something in your life right now today you're seeking the Lord with, and you're saying, Lord, and here's what we all do. I'm not sure. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. And I really believe that through God's word today, he's going to help us with that. So let's pray. Father, we come to you today, Lord. We're just so grateful for City Church. I am, Lord, what they mean to me. And Father, as we say every week, Lord, speak to us powerfully through your Spirit, all of us collectively, and at the same way, Lord, individually, the Spirit, Jesus, that you that are within us, speak to us in a unique way, that the reason that we came here today was to hear from you. And I know that you are so all-powerful and all-knowing, that if we're open today with our hearts, you will begin to show us, whether it hurts or whatever it might be, unsure, loneliness, fear, you will without a doubt give us peace and begin to show us the next step. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the church, the local church, and the time that we have together today. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to look at Philippians chapter 1 and verse 9, one of the most familiar verses in the Bible. We know many churches use it, is in verse 6. What God has started in you, what Jesus started in you, he's going to complete. And that is a principle that you can just kind of log today. I want you to look at Philippians chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 9 and 10. I'm just going to look at verse 9, and then we'll look back at verse 10. And this I pray, this is the apostle, and he's speaking here. He says that your love, in other words, the love that you have, is going to do something. It's going to abound still more and more. How does that happen? And knowledge, in other words, wisdom from God, and discernment. In knowledge and discernment. You know, don't you hate this when you're a kid and your parents used to say to you, well, just wait till you're my age, then you'll understand. I just can't explain it to you, but you will understand someday. You know, we used to hear that. And, you know, and to bring that into my life, I often think of this because it is so true what happened to me. When I was like around like 18 to 22, I would buy and sell muscle cars. And if you don't know what a muscle car is, to me, they're the cars of the 60s and maybe a little bit into the 70s. And, you know, you could work on them easily and the whole thing. And they had big block engines in them and everything. And I used to buy and sell those. And I'll never forget, my dad gave me my dad gave me a loan to start in this whole process. And I thought, you know what? I don't think I ever paid my dad back for that first loan. But anyways, So I get this. I'm in one of the muscle cars that I have, and I've got it all cleaned up. The engine's running good, and everything's clean. And I pull up to a stoplight. Now, there's a guy next to me. This is so vivid in my mind. There's a guy next to me. He's probably 28, 30. Looks a little tired. You know, just when car seats start to come out, there was a car seat in there, Hank, and the car, the muffler was kind of loud and smoking a little bit. There was some rust on the vehicle. And I look over, I look at this car, and I go, man, I say, so what's wrong with this guy? Why does he get his muffler fixed and, you know, the rust on the car? What's the deal, you know? Now, let me take the remote control, and I'm going to fast forward real quick with me going from 20 to 29 where he was. Click. The next thing I know, I'm 29 years old. I'm that guy. We got the car seats. The car's kind of having problems with the headliner, you know. So when you drive, we're living in Florida. When you drive, you know, because it's so hot there, the ceiling, if you know anything about vehicles, underneath the headliner, there's like a black, if you will, padding, mat. And it was dry rot. So in other words, it would all come down. So it was like, you know, when you're a kid and you go in the backyard and the tent's there, but it's not big enough. So you walk around hitting your head on the tent all the time. Every time you drive and I'd have the windows down, you're like bending down because all the whole ceiling's coming in on you. And the car needed some work. And I would often flash back to that situation. Actually, I got a really brainy idea with that. And I just cut the whole headliner out. You know, and I thought, you know, that's a great idea. So I cut it out, no problem. Start driving. Because of all the dry with that black felt, it would sprinkle all on you as you would drive down the road. It was just wonderful. It was wonderful. But I would often think about that. Me, here I was, 19 or 20, in that muscle car, completely cleaned up, ready to go out. You know, when you're that age, that you know, you look at your watch, oh, it's only 10 o'clock at night. Wow, the day's just beginning. Sure. Now it's like 10 o'clock. Well, you know, you don't even begin to think to go outside. Anyways, so here I am, and I'm thinking of having this flashback, you know, and I still do have that and remember that day. And because it's so stuck with me. As a matter of fact, I was there. I was working an extra job besides working the church down there and just exhausted, and the car needed work, and I didn't have the energy to clean it. You know, when kids are babies, you know, those little Cheerios are all over the car. They're everywhere, you know. So it was just a mess. And I would often think about that. Here's the deal with the message today with that. I didn't have the knowledge within me, the discernment and the experience to begin to think that way. I had to get to the place to where I grew into that. And only through time and understanding did I get it. And this is where we are today. We're driving that muscle car in some ways, if you're here and you're looking and you can't comprehend why someone is not doing something. You can take that into any area of your life. You don't quite understand. It's because we're not sure. We don't have the reservoir. I mean, that's the very first thing I want to start off with today is this. You and I have the reservoir. The reservoir is this. It's called wisdom. It's there. It's there for us. It comes through we know Jesus Christ. So let me read this again and bring it into practice. And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more. How does our love grow? Do you ever think about that? How do you love in a greater way? Is it just do some people love each other more because they've been married 20 years instead of 10 years? I don't think so. How does that happen? How does your love grow? This is how it grows. If you want to know and have a greater love in your life, in all of our lives, and we want to really love each other the way that we should, he tells us right here. And this I pray, that your love may abound. In other words, it's going to grow still more and more. How is that? In knowledge and in all discernment. When you have wisdom from the Lord, and you have discernment. So let me explain that for a minute. Wisdom is a reservoir that God gives you. Wisdom is only something in this life that you are able to understand because it comes from heaven. Wisdom only comes from heaven, nowhere else. So the wisdom that we get comes from the Lord Jesus Christ that we have. And then it's just as important, as you know, as we live here by Akron Canton Airport, and we see a lot of times coming to church on Sunday morning, you'll see a plane coming in. And growing up in an airplane with my father and him being a missionary pilot and all different places, Dad would go and we would go with him. It was most of the time it was a twin engine or turboprop. And what was so important, you had to have both engines working together. What in your life is this in life? Wisdom, remember how we started today? You can have this right here next to your bed. You can have it in your car. You can have it on your app. But if we don't take advantage of this wisdom that we have, that God has really given to us, it'll never go into discernment. So in other words, all of us know, you can really know today, that some of you actually know what the answer is or where you can get the answer to your problems. But are we willing to have the faith as we read God's word? The wisdom is there. We ask the Lord for wisdom. The important step and why so many of us struggle is the next step. It's the wisdom, it's the knowledge, but it's your next step. Discernment. Discernment, if you look it up, I love one of the examples that it gives as a definition. Discernment says, it's very basic. Discernment means to see. You can see. In your life right now, where is it that you can't see? So how does that come together? The way that comes together, when you have the wisdom that you ask the Lord for wisdom and it's in there, the Lord says, I'm going to give you the action plan. So how do you do that? You and I have to be willing to take a step of faith. I don't know what it is in your life or in my life, but when we do this, it actually does something so amazing in your life. When you are actually calling upon the Lord, you have to say, Lord, help me to see. What does he do? I believe he does three things. He helps you see evil. He's helped you see what is good, and he shows you the next step. It's very basic. You know, I've always tried when I speak, when we come in here every week, not to get it complicated, and big words and all the things and all the jargon that we could use and different theological arguments and so forth. We just keep it basic. When you ask the Lord for wisdom, he's going to give it to you. The action plan is, are you willing to have and take it and see? You say, Dallas, how do we do that? How do we do that then? Every week I'm going to drive it home to you. The wisdom, the Holy Spirit that you have in your life, Jesus lives within you. This is Jesus. Jesus here wants to come in and hit right here with you, with the Jesus in you and your spirit. The Holy Spirit connects with what's in here. Do you know that you have everything that you need in this life to be successful right now today? You have everything. If you're here today as a Christian, as I said last week, Jesus doesn't create losers. He saves losers. He doesn't create losers. In other words, in your life, you will be successful if you realize you have everything that you need, but yet what do? You know what? You know what's amazing? That isn't there some people in life? They'll go to 10 different people and ask them their advice. What do you think? Now you'll think of somebody else, and you'll type them up on Facebook. What do you think about this? What do you think? And you throw it out, and then you put it out on Twitter. What do you think? What do you think? You're getting thousands of people. What do you think? And guess what? You're going to still do it yourself the way you wanted to do it in the first place, anyways. It doesn't matter. That's our problem. Our problem is we think that we know how to do it. What did we come here for today? We came here hopefully to worship the Lord in music and in the message. And not just to say, you know what, I got to show up here because this is, you know, I was raised, I'm supposed to go to church. If I don't, I'm going to get in trouble. And if I don't get in trouble by my parents growing up, I'm going to get in trouble by the Lord this week. And that's the way we think. What I want you to get is this. The blessing of you being here today is the Lord is going to try and tell you something, that your Christian life can be so successful. All you have to do is understand the basics. The basics is you have the Holy Spirit in your life. The Holy Spirit is going to teach you by His wisdom. How do we gain His wisdom? We gain His wisdom by His Word. And when you love in a greater way, you will abound more in wisdom, and then you will see. When you live the way Jesus wants you to live, and love and not get bitter, because guess what happens the older that you get in life? You can get bitter real easy. Is what people have done? Maybe what you think the Lord has done. You know, I always tell people, anything bad, don't blame God, blame the devil. God didn't do that to you. So as you look at your life and you say, discernment, how do I see? It's the Lord, it's so easy. The Lord says, and we're going to close that verse. If you ask the Lord for wisdom, you know He said He will give you as much as you need. So here it is today. Some of us are struggling so much more than we would have to. You know why? Because all the wisdom that we need is right here. We know it, we have it, we're a Christian. But as we look to the Lord, what else does He say? Let's look at a couple more verses and we'll close. I want you to go to the Old Testament, to the wisest person in the Old Testament, or the wisest king that we ever know lived, in 2 Chronicles. In chapter 9, 2 Chronicles chapter 9, the word got out all over the world about King Solomon. He would be wealthier than anybody that you could even imagine today if you put Bill Gates and a few others together at the top of the charts, and all these guys together wouldn't come close to how wealthy King Solomon was. The Queen of Sheba heard about how wealthy that this king was. She just really couldn't believe it. She lived like 1,500 miles away. If you're at the very tip of Saudi Arabia, you'd have to go all the way up past Saudi Arabia and then over into Israel. I don't know how long it probably took her to get there, but she was so taken back by all the world that knew of the wisdom of Solomon, she had to see it for herself. And so she finally makes the trip. She gets there, and she decides that she's going to ask Solomon every question that she could think of that had to do with anything personal, anything in the world, anything about life. And this is what happens in 2 Chronicles chapter 9. 2 Chronicles chapter 9 and verse 5. We pick up the story. She finally made it there. And she sees this massive amount of wealth in the city that he has built, and the way and the structure of the economy and all that's taking place under Solomon. Then she said to the king, this is the Queen of Sheba talking to Solomon, "It was a true report which I heard on my own land about your words and your wisdom. However, I did not believe their words until I came and saw with my own eyes, and indeed, half of the greatness of your wisdom was not told to me. You exceed the fame of which I heard. Happy are your men, happy are those that are your servants who stand and continue before you and hear your wisdom. Blessed be the Lord your God who delights in you, setting you on his throne to be king for the Lord, your God, because your God has loved Israel to establish them forever. Therefore, he made you king over them to do justice and righteousness." Do you know, as a Christian here today, you know what we don't stop and think about enough? Every one of us. That you, all of you, are a leader. We don't think about that. You think, you say, me, Dallas, so I drive a truck, or I do these different things, and nobody really sees. You're a leader. You're a leader, every one of you. And God instills that wisdom for a purpose. You know, life can be, I was reading an article not too long ago, it was probably 6 months ago. Do very many of you, I'm kind of curious about this, so I want you to raise your hand if you know. I know you'll know if you're under 20, but here we go with that age again, right? How many of you know what Minecraft is? Do you know? Could you raise your hand if you know what Minecraft is? Okay. Very few. Okay. Minecraft is this, it's like this game, or it's like this, it's like this storybook video thing to where these kind of, and it's kind of hard to explain. I needed a kid up here to explain it for me. It's these square guys who chase all these square cows around or whatever, and they keep building these, like, square block buildings, and it could go on. You could play this game for hours, okay? Now, this guy, I believe he was from Sweden, and he was just sitting at his computer one day, and he started this game, and it became elaborate, build it, all his own. All by himself, just him. I think it was 2 years ago that, and I'm trying to go back in the story. I believe it was Microsoft. Maybe it wasn't Microsoft, it was Google, one or the other. They bought that game and all the products, because, you know, you'll see kids, they have it on their t-shirts. You can go to Toys R Us, and there's the Minecraft stuff and all this and everything. It was billion, I think it was a couple $1 billion. That they just wrote a check for this guy. $2 billion. Well, the reason I'm telling you that is he talked about just last year, now he's got billions, he has one of the most expensive homes in Los Angeles, and he talked about his own words. He talked about how miserable he was. He went on and on and on. And what he thought was gonna happen did it. Now, let me bring it to you as a Christian. I believe, because I know my own life, there's never been a time that when the Lord has done something, and then the Lord has blessed and does what he does, or he brings you through a trial, that you will never look back and say, I wish I was back there. You see the difference? The difference is the world's way, the world's wisdom, the world's wealth. There's nothing wrong with being wealthy. But if you have a goal for that, I want to share with you, you're not going to be happy. We are all looking for some type of joy and peace. And what she is saying here, what she sees, is Solomon. I see something so important as I see. Yes, I see this a massive amount of wealth like no other. But the people that are here, your family, you, everybody else, there's a joy that I see that I don't see. See, that's what made the difference. She's been around other kings that were extremely wealthy, but he was able to give her wisdom and answers of the things that she couldn't understand about life. How many times, question for you, even right now, whatever it is in your life today, did you ask whatever you're struggling with right now, or whatever you're unsure of that you can't see, have you asked the Lord for wisdom this week? You know, the reason I say that is because you're driving your car, and you're thinking about a million different things on a way that you got to do to make this happen. And this is the only way that you see that it's going to work out. You see where I'm getting at? We've made life too difficult. And you are made, or in other words, you grow up from the time that you crawl or walk to eat on your own, to do things that you are going to say, you know what, I can do this myself. I'm here to tell you that you can't. I'm here to tell you, you want to go ahead and do it yourself? Go ahead. You're going to make life difficult for yourself. So what you need is not just the wisdom, you need the discernment which Solomon had to put it into action. To put it into action. In other words, to see. When you see, and this is the key, and this is what I want to get at. When you can see, what does somebody else do? They hold on to you, the ones that are in darkness. They can't see. See what Solomon did? All the world knew where his wealth came from. And his wisdom. It came from God. Through the power of the Lord Jesus Christ today, you underestimate his power. You know, there's been situations in my life, and all of a sudden the Lord comes through, and I can think about them right now, and in some really tough times, and all of a sudden the Lord came through, and if I would have tried to figure it out after the fact, I would have never thought it would have happened that way. It wasn't even in there. See, it's not in there. The Lord is going to just zap it right into your life. The thing is this, are you willing to pull back on everything and how you're trying to figure it out, ask the Lord for wisdom, take the step of faith of where is it, what is it? It just gives you a little glimpse of where you know that you can see that you got to take that step. That's all he asks you to do. Just take the step. Doesn't mean you got to quit your job. Doesn't mean you got to do all these other things. It just means you have got to be willing to take the step. And you know what he'll do? He'll do it in such a way, and this is why you're still here. The guy that I talk about that was a billionaire, that was so miserable, you know one of the reasons that he was? He says, this is what he said. He says, all my friends are at work. I don't have anybody to play with. Now here's the thing, here's what I want to get at with us. What is life if it's all about me? You were saved for a reason, too. To give you eternal life in heaven. And secondly, to bring other people with you. That's why. The Lord gave all this to wisdom, and this is what she says. And we'll look at one more verse and close. This is what the Queen of Sheba said. Verse 8. Blessed to the Lord your God who delights in you, setting you on his throne to be king for the Lord your God. She recognized God because your God has loved Israel. Let me read it again. Because your God has loved Israel to establish them forever. Therefore, he has made you king over them to do justice and righteousness. This is it. This is why we're here. We accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, and then your family and your friends is to reach them for heaven. You know, Ben's up here saying that day. Every time someone says I'm sick, I'm saying, that's not me. That's not me. You know, the cards, people are very nice getting me on these cards. And every time I look over the front of the card, it says 60 on it. I said, well, that's not me. I can't believe that. Do you realize how quickly your life flies by? And what the Lord is wanting us to see is to see him, and to see eternity, and to see heaven. See, when you start focusing on what the Queen of Sheba realized. She said, Solomon, God gave you the wisdom, and you've taken that wisdom and you put it into action, and you were able to see, and which is called discernment. And you're able to make decisions, wise decisions, discernment. And as you make those, other people see that. Your life becomes easier. And when other people see that, they want what you have. And all we got to do is open our life up and say, you know what? I don't understand why I had to go through. And you fill in the blank. I don't understand why I had to go through what I had to go through in my life. I don't like it when I look back on the last several years. I don't like it at all. But I know this, that God has taken it. And after lost everything and what he has done, I wouldn't have had the power when I talk to other people who've lost everything, to let them know without a doubt, if you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you really, really believe who he is, you will have a life far more than you could ever think or imagine or believe, if you're willing. See, those trials in your life, those difficulties, and now that you work through them and you get through the other side, whatever it may be. Do you think God did that? No. But the devil did it to just knock you down again and again and again. And the Lord's saying, you know what? You trusted me. You got through this. I'm going to take what the devil tried to do to destroy you, and we're going to use that for my glory, meaning his glory. And you know, because of the heartaches and the things that you've been through in life, if you're willing, with that wisdom, you take it in discernment. Because she said, you know, every answer you had for me that I asked, the people that are around you will ask you, what is, here it is, what is the hope that you have? As we go so fast through this life, he is so amazing that he will get you around the same people that have had adversity, that the same thing that you've been through. And you'll be able to share with them. And because you are now so blessed and the Lord is so working in your life, and they see what you have, the same as Queen of Sheba saw what Solomon had, she couldn't put into words what she saw. That's the same thing people see in your life. And because of that heartache and whatever it is that you've been through, and not knowing, not understanding, trying to figure it out, the Lord said, you know what? One of the blessings is going to be, now you're on the other side, you're going to bring it. There's going to be somebody else in heaven because of what you've been through. You know what the example we're going to close with in just a minute. You know, it said that she gave Solomon so much gold, and so much, it was more than the mind could even imagine because of what she had heard and what she'd been blessed with. The Bible tells us. And Saul said, no, wait a minute. You gave me this, but you know what? I'm going to give you back twice as much as you came to give me. So why would that be there in the Bible? Because you can never, the example that Solomon gives us today, that you can never outgive God. And when you ask him for wisdom, it says in the book of James, if you ask the Lord for wisdom, he'll give you as much as you need. Take that wisdom. Take it. Read it. It's right here, as we say every week. Take it, think on it, meditate on it. And as the Lord gives you that wisdom, you're going to be able to take it as the other prop on that plane and turn it into discernment. And as you see in this life, as your marriage, as you work through those adversities, as your life, as your work, as your health, as tragedy, I don't know what it is that you've worked through, but as you do that, the Lord says, I'm going to bless you. See, we forget that. Do you know whatever you're going through on the, we want to get on the other side. I can't wait till I get through whatever I'm going through. We want to get on the other side. The Lord's saying, don't wish your life away. You know, I hate to bring this news to you this morning, but you're always going to have some problems. There's always going to be a giant in the land, but it keeps you sharp. It keeps you focused. It keeps you battle ready. You're going to enjoy the blessings of the Lord, but there's always going to be something there to where you have to rely on the Lord. The key is this. The key is when you have that discernment, you know what? Life becomes easier. We struggle. When I sit down with people, I see in just a few sentences why they are where they are. And I don't say this to get down on them. Are you reading God's word? Well, you know, right, I know they're not, since I hear that as an answer. They're not reading it. So as we finish, it's just this simple. As I was praying about the end of the message this week and last night and going through everything, I don't have something to finish with today. Because you know why? It's not about a story. It's not about something that happened to me. It's about you. And are you willing to ask the Lord for wisdom and turn it into discernment? You can have all the money in the bank, but if you don't take it and use it constructively, you're going to die with this wealth, vast fortune that you never use. That's exactly what you have as a Christian today. God gives you this wealth. And if you're just willing to take just a few minutes a day, it is amazing what you will be able to see and work through. And if the answer is not there, you're going to have peace to know that God is going to get you through. And when you do, and I don't know when your life is over, the miracle is today, and I want you to get this, whatever you've been through in this life, if other people come to you, they come to you to ask you for the hope that you have in you. As I said, as people said today, I'm 60. How old are we? How fast is this going by? Our friends and our family. See, I love that verse, and then we're done, because it says this. You don't have to work it. They will come, your adult kids, your co-workers, they will come to you and ask you, why do you live a certain way? And you will be able to share the hope that is in you. Because you've asked the Lord for wisdom. He's put it into discernment. You've been able to see. Discernment just says to see. You know what to do next. That's God. And when you do that, it's going to be amazing, because God's word tells us your life, and you and I don't realize this, we don't think about it, is a vapor. It is here, it is gone, there is heaven, and there is hell. And it is all forever. And when you are able to talk to other people, and you see them accept Jesus as their Savior, and you know that they're going to be in heaven forever, the billions of that other guy that I talked about, hopefully someday that he'll know Jesus, that was so miserable, he had everything the world had to offer, but he was lost. We have everything. We can see. Will you just ask the Lord for wisdom today? And whatever it is, he'll turn into that discernment where you can see. And if it's your marriage, if it's a job loss, if it's a health situation, if it's loneliness, if it's unsure of the future, or if it's your finances and you don't know what to do, the Lord, you are his child. And as the Queen of Sheba said to Solomon, Solomon, the Lord gave you, that's you today, the Lord gave you, you are blessed, you are here today, you know God's word, you are here, the Lord gave you what he gave you. He gave to Solomon, that's what she said, that's what she saw. The Lord gave you this, Solomon, because he loved his children, because he loved the children of Israel. He gives you what he gives you, not just for yourself, but for your family, your friends, and everybody that you come in contact with. So you and I someday, will lead them to Jesus and through the blood of Jesus Christ and his shed blood on the cross of Calvary. You will see them in heaven forever. Let's pray. Their heads are bowed today. Let me ask you, where is it in your life that you don't know what to do? Is it an adult child? And you're really going to work it, and you're going to overstep your boundaries and say things you shouldn't say, do things you shouldn't do? Or are you just going to ask the Lord for wisdom? Lord, just give me wisdom. Is it a health situation? Is it a tragedy? I don't know what it is, but I know this. The Lord loves you so much that you are unique. He's had you here today because you're struggling. He's had you here today because you don't know what to do. And he's saying to you, will you just let me handle it? And if you do, I'll show you what to do. I'll give you my wisdom, and then I'll show you the next step. You want life even easier. You want to relax and enjoy your family and your friends and enjoy every day. I do. And give it to the Lord today and watch what he'll do. Father, we come to you today. If there's someone here that doesn't know you as their Savior, Lord, we always give the invitation, always open. If someone doesn't know you, they don't know what to do, Lord. May they come forward and ask you into their heart. Father, if there's someone here today, and we know many are, that aren't sure what to do next, take the anxiousness away from them. Jesus, through your Spirit, give them this unbelievable peace that they will see the next step. That's all that can happen sometimes, Lord. We know that. But the next step is another step until we begin to see and we get stronger. And Lord, we forget sometimes as I close today that we are just not here about us. We're here about our family, about our kids, about generations to come that don't hear about you, Lord, about our co-workers, about somebody that we might not ever see again. Lord, whether we're traveling or whether it's in a grocery store, may people see your light and love. And as our love grows, the light shines greater, and we can tell others about you. So, Father, may we always be willing to give the hope to other people in this life that goes by so fast. Jesus, all of us, we just ask you right now. Lord, I just ask for everybody here today that right now we would ask you for wisdom in every area of our life and turn it into discernment to where we can see. Lord, we love you because you first loved us. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you stand with us today?